Mic check. Oh, it's there. You can hear me. So let's start. Okay. Hi everyone. Thanks for coming. So today we will be talking about configuration management at its peak with Foreman. Before that, my name is Rahul Bajaj. I work at Red Hat, and at Red Hat I mostly work on the Foreman project. So a quick survey, how many of us have ever heard about the term Foreman, have used it, existing users? Raise your hands. Oh, there are quite many. Nice. Okay, that's fine. And how many of us don't know anything about Foreman, have never heard about it, never tried it out? Raise hands. Okay, that's fine. Okay. So at the end of this talk, I hope the people who actually know about Foreman, they would learn something new, and the people who've not really heard about it, maybe I'll convince you to look into it. So what are we going to look at today? So we're going to look at what is Foreman. We'll look at the core components. We'll look at scenarios in which Foreman can do provisioning. And then we'll see how configuration management works with Foreman, right? So how many of us know about Ansible? Ever heard about Ansible? Used Ansible? Okay, a lot of us. Puppet, how many of us use Puppet? Heard about it? Okay, awesome. What does these configuration management tools do? They help us configure our nodes, right? So once you have an operating system, you install your Puppet or Ansible or any configuration management tool, and you try to configure your nodes, right? That's how it works. But what about the initial installation of operating system? And what about updates and drift management? So the slide that you see right now is typically a life cycle of a server, right? First you install, then you have initial configuration, then you have updates and management, right? Drift management. So this is the entire life cycle of a server. All your configuration management tool does is the initial configuration, but Foreman is a complete life cycle management tool, right? So this is the architecture for Foreman. This is the basic architecture for Foreman, where you have Foreman in between and you have different components surrounding it, right? So let's look at each component bit by bit. So on the very top, you see smart proxies, right? What are smart proxies? Smart proxies are small modules or small programs that help you consume those services which are not really easily accessible through APIs, such as DNS, DHCP, TFTP. These services are being provided to you by smart proxies. The next module is Puppet. So we have this feature called ENC. How many of us know about ENC? Anyone? Okay. So ENC, what ENC does is it tells Foreman, hey Foreman, I have this node, I need to configure it. Tell me what should I do with it. So Foreman will give all the configurations to the Puppet ENC, and ENC will take care of the implementation. That's what Puppet does with ENC, right? So that's about Puppet, and we have these compute resources. So Foreman can do spin up AWS machines for you. It can spin up Libvirt machines for you. It can spin up OpenStack machines for you. So we have a lot of compute resources that we can do provision for you, right? Next part is authentication. So Foreman has integration. Foreman is integrated with the LDAP and the Active Directory server. Foreman is basically a Ruby on Rails application. So you can have databases like PostgreSQL or MySQL or any relational databases. To know that Foreman has a very strong RBAC model, so you can actually restrict all the users that you want, and you can give them access as and how you require to give it. Okay, so web user and API. So Foreman has a web UI. It also has a CLI for itself, and this CLI consumes the API. So if you want whatever actions that you can perform on the UI, those all actions you can perform through CLI. It also has a very nice API so that you can consume it in the way you want. One good feature about Foreman is that it has a plugin architecture, right? So I know a lot of people who use Foreman only for provisioning, or you know, a lot of people only use Foreman for, you know, its Puppet integration, or maybe its Ansible integration, or maybe a lot of people only use it for reporting. So it's upon you what you want to use Foreman for. Yeah, so these are the three major functionalities of Foreman, right? One is provisioning, configuring, and the third one is monitoring. So we will see in what scenarios Foreman can perform provisioning, right? So first is Pixie-based. So Foreman can do Pixie-based provisioning. If you have your DNS and TFTP servers, DHCP servers and TFTP servers available, you can do Pixie-based provisioning. Now how that works is that the machine that you want to provision sends a DHCP, sends a request to the DHCP server. Now the DHCP server provides it an IP address and gives it the gives it the address to the TFTP server. Now this TFTP server would provide it with initrd and VM Linux, which would help it to boot, right? So that's how Pixie-based provisioning works. And talking about IPXE provisioning, in IPXE provisioning, we have a host already registered on Foreman. You need to take a screenshot of it, have it downloaded as an ISO, and then you can use that ISO to provision the latter machines. So talking about Foreman discovery. So to provision, we also do bare metal, right? Bare metal provisioning. So talking about bare metal provisioning, we use this plugin called as Foreman Discovery. Now, what Foreman Discovery does is that suppose if you have some bare metal, you boot the Discovery ISO onto it, and what this Discovery ISO will do is it will send all the facts from the particular host to Foreman, and it will get registered under discovered hosts on Foreman. Once this host is registered on Foreman, you can consume it and you can provision it through Pixie. The same method that Pixie follows, right? Okay, so that's about provisioning. One more point about provisioning would be that we do all sorts of provisioning. Like earlier we started with a lot of bare metal, then we went on to virtualization, cloud, and now we even do containers. So you can provision almost any kind of machine that you're looking for, right? So configuration. So Foreman has a very tight integration with Puppet, okay? So how things work is that Puppet we use Puppet for ENC. For people who know Puppet, we also support parameterized classes and hierarchical parameter storage in Puppet. Okay, and for the rest, like Ansible, Chef, and Salt, you have plugins. You can just integrate those plugins into Foreman, and you can use them. Talking about configuration management, there are two specific architectures for configuration management. One is the push model, and one is the pull model. Let's talk about the push one. So there is one master, and you can see the worker nodes around it. In the push model, what you do is you try to write all the configurations on the master node, and then you push those configurations to your nodes, right? So that is how Ansible work, right? It does not need an agent. It only writes all its configuration on the server node, and then it pushes all its configuration towards its node. Talking about the pull model. In the pull model, the nodes pull themselves to the server at a particular time interval. So talking about Puppet, it has a 30-minute polling time by default. So after every 30 minutes, the nodes tend to pull all the configurations from the master node. So that's push and pull configuration. So I've got some demos to show how Foreman works with Puppet. First, we'll see how Foreman works with Puppet. Then we'll see how Foreman works with Ansible. And lastly, we'll see how it integrates with AWX, Ansible Tower, and how you can configure your machines. So I'm going to walk you through these demos. Okay. So you need to add Puppet classes, right? So this shows that there are no Puppet classes already available in Foreman. You install a Puppet Puppet module or Puppet class in your machine on the server node. Then you try to import that Puppet class. Next is that you try to add this Puppet class into your host group. So when you try to provision your machine, this Puppet integration, like the installation of the Puppet client and the Puppet master, is done automatically by Foreman. Now what this host group is, I'll just explain you how a host group works. So when you try to create a host, there are a lot of fields that you try to fill in to create a host. Now what happens is that if you pre-fill the host group, you can just inherit a host group, and that will inherit all the other fields, which you will see in just a minute. So we have host groups so that we don't have to fill these fields again and again. So once you create a host group, you can just inherit that and you will have these fields automatically filled. Although you have all these fields automatically filled up, you can still go on and change some of the fields if you feel that, you know, the particular host should have basically 1 GB memory or something like that. So we have a lot of templates that help you provision the machines, but you can also, the community provides, but you can also have your own templates made and you can use them. Now, if you see, we had this OpenSCAP client has been inherited from the host group. And it is also included in the parameters. Once you submit, the host will be created, and inside the host YAML file, which is created, you can see that the Puppet class that you had included is present. Great. So here you can see Foreman has installed this Foreman SCAP client. And if you see the finished template, so finished template is basically the kickstart file that is there, the template which supports kickstart file. So if you see this file at the end, we will have that OpenSCAP client installed on the client side. Right. So that's about Puppet. So that's how Puppet works with Foreman. Okay. Now we're going to see how Ansible integration works with Foreman. So in this demo with Ansible with Foreman, we will see how we can install. We'll see what are the different options that we have with Ansible and Foreman. Then we'll see specifically three things. We'll see how to install a package with Ansible, how to install a role from Ansible Galaxy, and then we'll just run a simple command and check what the output is. So we're going to perform all these actions on Ansible demo. This is just a host that I've created. We're going to run schedule jobs on it. So yeah, let me explain each one of them. So Ansible command is just for running a single command. Ansible Galaxy is to basically fetch a role from the Galaxy and run that role on the client. Ansible package is to basically install a package, remove a package. Ansible playbook is to run a simple Ansible playbook. Ansible power, okay. So Ansible power is to check the state of your machine, whether it's on, off, or what's the state of the machine. Ansible Puppet, okay, this is interesting. So as we know that Puppet clients tend to poll themselves to the server, right? So after every 30 minutes, they will try to fetch all the configurations from the server. But with this Ansible Puppet, it will just run Puppet agent-t. It will just try to poll at any time. Like, you don't have to wait for 30 minutes. So that's about Ansible Puppet. Ansible role installation, this is how you can install your roles from maybe locally from your machine, from GitHub, from any version control system that you are using. You can install your roles and run them on the nodes. Okay, so let's see the first one, Ansible commands. So I'm going to run ifconfig on the machine, Ansible demo, and we'll see the output. Just to mention, Foreman has a lot of graphs. It uses. This is the playbook that it just generated because with the submission that we had done. It creates this graph, and once this graph is green, we know that the job has the scheduled job has worked correctly. Yeah, now it's green. So we can go to job tasks, subtasks, and we can check how the playbook ran. So yeah, this is how the playbook ran. We have a debug module, so you can see the output here. That's about it. So that's like the first thing we saw is how to run a single command. Next, we'll see how to use Ansible Galaxy, like how to install a role from Ansible Galaxy. Here, if you see the role section, there are no roles right now. It's completely empty. That was the host that we're working on. Here is the Ansible Galaxy. I'm trying to install the role for MOTD. You just put the name of the role and you submit. and wait for the results to come. This is the template that, this is the playbook that it generated. It's very simple, Ansible Galaxy, install the item, that means the variable, which is MOTD, right? And we'll wait for the graph to complete. Yes, it's run successfully. You can see the output of the playbook again here, and successfully ran. You can see the output of MOTD, and it was installed successfully. Now, if you go back to the machine that we just saw that it had no roles. If you go back to that machine and you check the check the roles directory, you have the MOTD module. That's how you run a role. Now, the last part of this demo would be to see how we can install a single package on a particular node. So Ansible packages, we would like to install the latest version of that package, and the package name is ZSH. So if you do rpm-q ZSH, you will find no such packages here. And then you can run this playbook. Wait for it to get green. You can see the template. It's just a simple, it uses the package module to install the package, and that's it. It'll get green, and then we can see the output of the playbook in the job tasks. That's all. Yes, ran everything successfully, and now we have ZSH installed on the client. Okay. So the third video that I want to show you, the third demonstration that I want to show you, is about Ansible and AWS integration, right? So let's see that. So my aim to aim for this presentation would be, for this demo would be, that having the inventory show up in Ansible AWS, right? So let's see how to do that. So we log in, we go to all hosts. So these are the three hosts. I just want to show you that we have three hosts right now in our all hosts section. And we want to import this into the inventory of AWS. So we basically create inventory. We name it Foreman inventory. We go to sources and we create a new source. So you have a lot of sources in Ansible, Ansible Tower or AWS, you have a lot of sources. So I've selected custom script. So what a source would require is two things. One is a dynamic inventory file, and one is an INI file, which will give it all the you know, the credentials and the link towards Foreman, right? So I've provided a custom inventory script as my dynamic script, and this would be my INI file. And then I sync this information. Once the cloud becomes green on the very left side, you will be able to see all the hosts on Foreman at this inventory. Now, if you know AWS, then you can run your playbooks on AWS, right? Now, since you have the inventory prepared, you can write playbooks, you can, you know, install playbooks, roles, and then you can run it on them. So that's about the demonstration. There is one last thing, that is, AWS and Foreman has a tight integration. So there is this feature that that works, that is called as callback provisioning. Now, I would like to explain that in a few minutes. Now, how callback provisioning works. So Foreman, when Foreman is told to provision a machine, it could be a bare metal or any AWS or whatever machine, okay? And after that machine is provisioned, it is told to do some task, like it is told to do some configuration on it, right? Some pack, install some packages or something like that through Ansible Tower. Now, what will happen is when the machine goes to Ansible Tower or AWS to perform configurations, AWS then goes to Foreman. It goes to the server, it checks its dynamic inventory, the response comes back. It checks whether that host which wants to do the configuration is present in all hosts. If that machine is present in the inventory, only then Ansible Tower or AWX will do the needful. It will do the configuration for it. Okay, so I hope it was a bit helpful for you guys. You can visit our website if you are eager to know about Foreman. We keep doing a lot of activities and conferences. You can look us up at foreman.org. If you do something cool with Foreman, let us know. We are on IRC. We are on the Foreman-dev channel. And we also have a very vibrant and nice community at welcoming community at community.foreman.org. So I hope to see you guys soon. Okay, thanks.